getting free of the attempt to accomplish the impossible is almost impossible. So we have to laugh occasionally just how ridiculously difficult it seems, even though we're already free. Nobody's entrapped. How entrapped are we if we're simply dreaming a dream? You know, is that real entrapment? No. All we have to do is awaken from the dream. So we're not really entrapped at all. And yet while we're dreaming, we can dream that we're totally entrapped. Okay? So in a dream, we can make it seem like it's impossible within the dream to get free of what's going on in the dream. We can't get free of what's going on in the dream, right? But if we wake up, we're free of the entire dream. Okay, and this is what's being said here, is that we have to wake up from the entire dream, not try and escape from what's happening in the dream. Okay, but awaken from the dream itself. Very important. And then we'll see it's not really impossible. It only seemed impossible. But meanwhile, as we are still taking this dream to be real, we are extremely stressed out and wondering. Just every day becomes more and more confusing, the situation, really. In 1967, here in the Bay Area, in California, there was this resurgence of the Eleusinian mysteries. Eleusinian. Maybe illusory mysteries, Eleusinian mysteries, which lasted about 2,000 years in the area around Greece, up until about 4th century AD. That was the religion of that area. And what happened was that got suppressed, and then it erupted again in the summer of love in 1967, when people rediscovered ethnogens, plant-derived psychotropic agents like psilocybin, peyote, all the mescaline involved in that. Then LSD was manufactured, and everybody was, you know, just ingesting all that stuff, taking all that stuff. And just going crazy and going back to the times of the Eleusinian mysteries. The Eleusinian mysteries, which all the temples, the pagan temples in those times in Greece and the surrounding areas, and then in Rome, had all these temples to various deities, and these mysteries were celebrated every year. And the lesser ones and the greater ones every 5 years. And they ingested a beverage, kaikion, and nobody knows exactly what's in that beverage, but it's believed that there were psychotropic agents in that beverage that opened up some kind of revelatory experience of what they called God. And all of this stuff just suddenly exploded on the scene. Out of, you know, the 1950, everyone's very conformist and going to church and everything. And out of nowhere, it seemed like this eruption. Everybody was just going crazy. As you know, it seemed just going wild, getting loose, loosening up, getting free of certain restrictions, and feeling that they were experiencing God. The people at the beings, the lovings, the beings, all these happenings were ingesting, the whole group was ingesting LSD, and they all thought, oh, they're experiencing God, et cetera, et cetera. But what they really were experiencing was the subtler energy patterns, okay, and seeing beneath the surface of the more grosser energy patterns, and then thinking that they'd found God. But in truth, none of the energy patterns have anything to do with God. None of them. So that was like a false path. It was a false path. And of course, this is still going on and on and on and on and on with the Brotherhood of Eternal Love in Southern California. They pioneered all the drug routes from Afghanistan, Mexico, and they brought in all the drugs in to California and then spread out. And then in Berkeley, the Orange Sunshine was developed by Stanley, and it was just, you know, it's just spread out everywhere. And this has continued on and on and on and on and on. So people are getting more and more and more and more and more into the belief that these biological, these substances, call them whatever you want, are bringing them closer to God, because they're able to see subtler forms of energy. So, alters perception a little bit. But the truth is that there is no truth to this. Okay, it doesn't bring you closer to God. It brings you, it alters perception so you can see the subtler energy patterns. That has nothing to do with salvation, absolutely nothing. And yet, our culture has been inundated with this. I grew up in the epicenter of all of this stuff. And I was just like inundated, bombarded, terrorized by it, just crushed, you know, by all this eruption of you know, pre-Christian practices, and then a desperate effort for everybody to integrate the two. it was completely over the top, and the whole world is still reverberating from all of that, absolutely reverberating. It really, it was the dawn of another dark age. It was the dawn of the end of the world, as it really. People were seeking safety, okay, because the Cold War, okay, the dropping of the bomb on Hiroshima and Nagasaki really ushered in the advent, as it were, as the end of the world, as we know it for sure. Because then the Cold War erupted, and I literally grew up with an absolute terror of every day we would be annihilated by a bomb, nuclear bomb from Russia, living right here on the West Coast. And we had to build radar stations, early warning radar stations, all over to try and detect any incoming bombers. And of course, they had submarines that could launch them too, I imagine. They're working on that. And we lived under the threat of nuclear annihilation here on the West Coast. People, the rest of the U.S. and around the world probably didn't feel that at all. But on the West Coast, I literally got up every morning shaking in fear. And I wondered, was today the day we're going to get nuked? And so, of course, people here were looking for safety. Safety. Looking for safety. I mean, you know, it's time to give a retrospect that is honest and not all muddled up. We wanted to find safety. Where could we find safety? And we wanted to find assurance of an afterlife, you know, because we really felt we were going to be, you know, annihilated. And so everyone was seeking. We were seekers at that time in California. And we were desperate seekers. Literally, when you get up feeling that, you know, your whole world, I mean, the atomic bomb's going to be dropping, you know, you're like in a whole different state of mind. You're saying, wow, I need to get the answer. I need to get it real fast. You know, what's this all about? That's what we'd say. What is this all about? You know, what's life all about? We need to know the purpose right now. So there's this is the epicenter of urgency. Epicenter of urgency. And I've actually been here in my entire life and been under this incredible crush of urgency nonstop, entire life. And, you know, the Cold War after that kind of wore down a bit, with, you know, Bay of Pigs, getting past that, and was it like 60, 62-ish, something like that. And then along came the Vietnam War, and then we were terrified we were going to be drafted and sent over the jungles, you know, and we were not prepared for that. You know, suburban life doesn't exactly prepare you for that. And so there again was this urgency, like, you know, we may be, you know, sent away to die in some jungle. So it was a tremendous urgency. I remember during high school, we were just absolutely petrified. And we were, you know, making plans to move to Canada and all that. So again, this extreme sense of urgency. And then after that, the digital revolution happened right here. Right here. I mean, close by everywhere. And that also opened up a tremendous sense of urgency, because it was very messianic. This whole high-tech thing is extremely messianic, and they're saying this is it's not really spoken, there's an agenda underlying it. And it's like I said, another extreme urgency, because this was really like the height of distraction and believing in salvation, external salvation, of connecting bodies and people externally, which is what it's morphed into, right? That's how it's gone. And so, you know, from the very beginning, you could feel that. And that is exactly opposite of salvation, exactly opposite. So now everybody has their smartphones and they feel they're all connected to everybody else. People, bodies, personas, connecting externally to other bodies and personas, and believing that is going to be salvation. And the truth is, it's completely opposite of that. So again, extreme urgency here, as all these ways that are not it, you know, flooded in, people desperately clutching at straws. And again, no judgment here, no judgment. Because at times I've been caught up in all that stuff too. And understanding that the pressures of existence, the pressures of this dream are insane. And that we all are caught up in it. And we all are trying to figure out, where's our safety? Where's our home? Where's our happiness? You know. And there's no place like where I grew up and lived my whole life. That's the epicenter of it all. Just been under this crushing pressure my entire life. And just to literally, like you're drowning, have to literally get some air, have to keep working constantly on trying to clarify what the heck is going on. I finally got an ally when A Course in Miracles, I found A Course in Miracles in a bookstore called Wall and Pond. It's no longer there. It just happens, I just came across it. I said, what is this book? And I thought, you know, let me look at this. And I couldn't really understand what it was saying. So I went back a month later and got it. And it's really, for my money, it's the clearest, it's the tremendous aid to clarity, tremendous aid to clarity. And whoever shared that, these pointers with us, you know, is really something extraordinary, you know, whoever it turns out to be. I believe the pointers are accurate if we can see what it's pointing to. And unfortunately, I don't. It's been, what, 74, almost 40 years. Well, it came out in the late 60s. So really, it's been 40-plus years since the... Well, it didn't get published till 74, so it's been 38 years. There's still, for my money, there still aren't any good teachers. The teachers that I would go to and say, I need to know the truth. So the results have not been there. But I don't think that's the fault of the pointers. I think it simply illustrates the difficulty of awakening from this dream, because we keep trying to solve the problems within the dream, which is not the way to awaken from it. That's the way not to awaken from it. Okay, so there hasn't been success, really. I haven't seen any success with A Course in Miracles. It doesn't mean there won't ever be any, that the pointers are still completely valid, but we are just up against it here. So from my asking for guidance, it says just keep taping, keep working on this. End of September, something will really, you'll know the score by that time. Something really will come about. Meanwhile, it's moving time. We have to continue to clarify what in the world is going on, because within the dream of existence, as it were, there's so much going on. The great news is it's completely irrelevant to reality. It has zero relevance. So we don't have to figure out anything that's going on in the dream. But yet we think we do, because we think we're an identity in the dream, and we're not. So we just are struggling mightily. And until we wake up, we will continue to struggle mightily. I don't think there's any doubt about that. So I continue to assess the entirety of the situation, and just always trying to see, is there some way to help? Because again, if the help is put into the context of the dream, it's no good. It's no good. It doesn't work. It's useless. If the help is taken at some level to awaken from the dream, then the help is useful. The pointers are useful. The advice is useful. And this is a struggle in the world. No matter what I say, I can say it a million times. If it's put into the wrong context, it's useless. So it's this slight shift in purpose that is all important. But if we don't get it, then really we are just flailing away in futility. That is true. So I keep trying to, you cannot bring truth into a wrong context, false context, and understand it. It's not possible. Not possible. Seeing if something will come about here to be actually helpful. Help is really needed. The dream is really a very nasty dream. As I said before, the purpose of existence is death. That's the purpose, to build up the power of death. I've said that so many times. And yet again, it's not our purpose to try and stop this death, because what happens in the dream is irrelevant to reality. For instance, when you wake up from a dream in the morning, you say, that dream I was dreaming is not relevant to my waking life at all. This is not a perfect analogy, because a lot of stuff we dream actually is relevant. But the gist of it is that you could understand the what I'm trying to point out here. It's not like when you wake up from a dream and you look around, everything's okay. They say, well, I better go back into the dream and fix everything and tell everybody everything's okay. No, you don't need to go back into the dream and tell everybody in the dream that everything's okay. You need to stay awake. Don't go back into the dream. Don't try to externalize what is internal. That's the huge mistake. I know theosophy has talked about the externalization of the hierarchy. There can be no externalization of what is internal, because reality is entirely internal. reality is the awareness of the oneness, the seamless oneness. There are not minds to be joined. They're not all these separate minds that we need to join. That's a dream. There's only mind. There's only spirit. There's only reality and the functioning of that reality. There's no need to join anything. There's never been any separation. There's never been any fragmentation. So there are no fragments to join. So as we are trying to join in the dream, join together, that just heightens the delusion because there's nothing to join. There's never been any separation. Instead, we need to realize there's never been any fragmentation at all. The vision of oneness, the vision of unconditional love, shows us that fact. And so that is the goal, really. That is really, if we want to know what is the goal, that vision has to be the goal. It has to be the goal. Not the joining of fragments, but the vision to see that there's never been any fragmentation of reality at all. All fragmentation took place in the dream, and that dream is entirely relevant. And when we give up, when we choose a different cause, the effects of the other cause disappear. So what we're trying to do in the dream is to join together, right? Let's join, let's form groups, let's join here, let's join there. Let's bring this all, let's gradually knit it all together into oneness. That's exactly the opposite of what we should be doing. We should be allowing the vision of oneness to be seen, the unconditional love, which is equally distributed, equally overlaying the entire dream. Everything in the dream was overlaid from the very beginning of the dream. It's always been overlaid. Seamlessly overlaid, equally distributed, total peaceful stillness, the still, peaceful, tranquil, gentle overlay, which reflects reality to us. And then we say, there's no fragmentation of this overlay whatsoever. And that reminds us of the oneness of reality. There's never any fragmentation. Why did the dream of fragmentation arise? We've explained that over and over. Because we wanted to be prime creator, and meaning we had to change reality. And then we realized we can't change reality because we didn't create it. So we then had to try and find a way to convince the prime creator to change reality. And the prime creator said, no, reality is not changeable. So we then figured that we thought, well, we have to find a way to force the prime creator to change reality. So we dreamed up this scenario of death and loss. And that we dreamed up a scenario of how to manufacture a power that we didn't have before, so that we could bring this power and show the prime creator we have this now, this power, and force the prime creator to change reality for us. That's literally the whole narrative of behind the scenes. And so we dreamed of fragmentation because we couldn't harm reality in any way. We know that, but we thought if we have all these little fragments, and bit by bit by bit we kill them off, we keep raising more fragments than killing them off, gradually we'll build up out of all of this, gradually we'll sort of accrue a power. So you look at evolution, you look at all the history of the universe, we look at the planet, this planet, how many billions of years has there been, you know, stuff happening here, and then life forms, gradual evolution of all these little life forms, each one dying, right? Infinite dying. And gradually we're building up, more and more complexity, and having that die. Now the human body is the most, you know, complex, sophisticated organism on this planet, so to speak. And now it, you know, dying, millions, billions of deaths. And again, all to try and manufacture a power. We don't have the power to manufacture power. So all this manufacturing we've been doing is useless. Again, we are not human beings, we're spirit. We're spirit trying to manufacture this power, and we're simply using the tapestry of time and space to do this. We imagine time and space in the universe, and we're using it to try and build up this power. Why? Because we want to be prime creator. And in order to do that, we have to have reality be changed. And the fact is, reality cannot be changed. Even the prime creator cannot change it. The prime creator is it. Is the oneness that is it. There isn't any agency to change that. and we keep hoping that there is, that we can find it. And so we're on this futile quest. We're on a futile quest. And the more we raise this to awareness, the closer we get to unconditional love, to choosing unconditional love, which is like a reflection of reality. It reminds us of the oneness of reality that cannot be fragmented, cannot suffer any loss, equally distributed, you know, total oneness, total freedom, total fairness, total equality. That's already the case. And yet here we are fighting for equality within this scenario, hypothetical scenario of manufacturing this power of death, of loss. And we're struggling, fighting, you know, instead of setting down this cause, the causal desire to be prime creator, and picking up the causal desire to not be prime creator, which would show us in this vision of unconditional love. This, you know, instead of doing that, we're desperately trying to solve the problems of existence, which we don't realize that they are unsolvable. That, you know, we're just shuffling a deck of cards, but the cards are the same. The effects of existence remain. The dynamics remain the same. The purpose remains the same. The song remains the same. It cannot be changed. You cannot have a causal effect, cause bringing about effects that are somehow divorced and separated from that cause. And yet, because we're trying to divorce and separate ourselves, spirit, from prime creator, the cause, we believe that is possible. That it's possible to separate cause and effects. We believe it's possible, and so we keep on trying to do that, you know, trying to bring peace here on earth. You hear it all the time, even from so-called top teachers, and this is entirely delusional. You cannot bring peace anywhere in the cosmos. It's ridiculous to even suggest such a thing. Everything is supremely vulnerable in existence, and that holds absolutely nothing that we want. We don't really want vulnerability. Everything is subject to death here, to loss. Everything in existence. And so it doesn't matter what kind of civilization we raise up. None of that matters at all. It's a waste of time, total waste of time. Everything we do in existence is a waste of time, except for raising this fact that it is a waste of time to awareness, raising that up so we see it. That is not a waste of time. That's proper use of time. But everything else is simply a waste of time. Dream of loss is the dream of loss. The hypothetical scenario of trying to create a power to coerce God is simply that, a hypothetical scenario to try and create a power to coerce God. That's what it is. It is what it is, and it's futile. And yet, what we do is we point to this futility as evidence, quote-unquote evidence, that something unexpected must happen, because we had no success, and we cannot understand no success. We were not created to understand that at all. So we inherently believe success must come. That's the, you know, there's, in reality, there's no such thing as no success. Cause and effect automatically, effects arise from cause. There's no such thing. And yet here we are, and we're trying to have this power come from all these effects of loss. And we haven't got it yet. And so we keep thinking that, you know, it has to occur this next moment. It must occur this next moment. Every moment we believe for sure it's going to happen this next moment. Squirrels are squirrels, you're in conflict. Hannah. And it never comes. And we can't believe it. We keep saying, I can't believe it. You know, what's going on? Well, the success of this idea is all the scenario of loss. That is it. That's it. The attempt to manufacture this power is the experience. So we've already been experiencing existence. And we don't realize that. We think that we haven't yet experienced it, and that the next moment we will experience it. We'll experience the success, that the power that we're seeking. Never will. But we've already been experiencing existence. There isn't any next moment to existence, to experience existence. We've always been experiencing it, and yet we never believe that we are experiencing it. We can't believe it. It doesn't seem possible to us. And it never will seem possible to us. So there is this emptiness. Existence does have this emptiness, this futility. That feeling of futility is the experiencing of it. So don't try and drown this feeling of futility. Really, if we had enough clarity, we would simply totally embrace this feeling of futility and be completely aware of it, and then set it down, set the cause of it down. That would be the quick way. If anyone wants a quick way to be free, it is a way of realization. This futility, feeling of futility, is it, and not to try and seek anything other than that, because that just perpetuates time, you know, your time, your delay, just delay. Feeling of futility is the experience of existence. That's what it is. And then you say, well, I don't really want that. That's right. We don't really want this idea of trying to be prime creator. We didn't realize at the beginning that we didn't really want it. You know, because we thought maybe God, the prime creator's bluffing, and that prime creator can change reality. But now we know it's not a bluff. It's not a bluff. It's either, I'll tell you this. If prime creator is bluffing, then prime creator is unbelievably terrible, sadistic, right? Why would prime creator, if prime creator had the ability to change reality, why didn't prime creator do it immediately? Why put us through this horrible nightmare, you see? So we're stuck on the horns of a dilemma. Because if we say that prime creator can change reality, we also have to admit that prime creator is absolutely, completely sadistic and terrible, you know? But on the other hand, if prime creator cannot do it, then we can say, wow, prime creator, therefore, there's no basis to say prime creator is sadistic and horrible and terrible. It's just that we just hoped that it could be changed, but it could never be changed. So prime creator has simply been waiting for us to realize this. And therefore, the loving God is, we can see that, yeah, a God really is a God of love, and not some super mean prime creator that is withholding what we really want. So we're caught in this sort of dilemma of which is it. And if we believe that the prime creator has been holding this power back from us, changing reality, this power to change reality, then we have to believe that prime creator is absolutely terrible. Why hold it back for so long? You know, and have us suffer, and try to manufacture all this death, you know, try to coerce, you know, if they could have, prime creator could have done it all along. How terrible is that, really? So divergent opinions of prime creator couldn't be more divergent, right? It could not be more divergent. One is this absolute tyrant withholding what we really want and causing us to go through all this death and suffering. The other is completely loving, benevolent prime creator that has no such power and is just waiting for us to realize this, you know. And so those are the two divergent views, depending on what you believe. Obviously your destiny will be wrapped up in that belief, will be guided by that belief. So they're like two different belief systems, really, two very divergent belief systems. And what we're doing is we're tapping into the belief system that the prime creator has no such capacity to change reality possible, and then, you know, letting that unfold, letting that belief system bring to us what it has for us. And we hopefully it will come soon, because there's a lot of conflict in the world. There's a lot of loss. There's a lot of intense death planned. A lot of loss planned here for those who are still believing that the prime creator has capacity to change reality and feel a need to coerce that change, to hold a sword over the head, you know, the prime creator saying, you better do it now or else I'm going to bring this sword down, the sword of death upon you. And they even take the crucifixion of Jesus as proof that they can kill the prime creator. They said, look, the Son is one with the prime creator. If we can kill the Son, that means we can kill the prime creator. And therefore, we must have this power. You see? The belief is we must have the power to kill God. Therefore, all we have to do is wait for God to realize this. And so God will change reality and make us prime creator. You know, we're in the catbird seat of bargaining if we believe that. So very divergent belief systems here in the world, extraordinarily so. So when we talk about parting of the ways, parting of destiny past, we talk about translation and the paradise and the conflicts of the world, the catastrophes and troubles to come in this world, we're talking about that, you know, the parting of the ways of these two belief systems. The two belief systems cannot be integrated. Cannot. Either the prime creator can change reality or not. Where is the integration? Can anyone anywhere in the entire universe explain how these two can be integrated? How these two belief systems can be integrated? I've been waiting my whole life for that explanation. There's not been a single explanation given at all at how these two can be integrated. Either the prime creator can change reality or the prime creator cannot change reality. There is no middle ground at all. So we cannot possibly be waiting for some integration to take place. That's just, you know, insanity. And we're not really insane. You know, I know that we get thrown out a lot. But what we are is we're bluffing, so to speak. We're hoping, we're bluffing, we're thinking, maybe this will work. We're not sure. We're thinking, maybe if we just wait, you know, if we just, if maybe prime creator's bluffing, we're not sure. So we keep building up this power of loss to threaten the prime creator. So we're not waiting for integration, we're waiting to, we believe, the belief system of loss is that the prime creator is weakening and weakening. With every loss, the prime creator is looking at all this loss and saying, oh my gosh, this power is getting stronger and stronger and stronger. One day it's going to be so powerful that it will could be able to destroy reality, so I better make a deal. So we're waiting for this deal to be done. Okay, we're not really insane. I reject the whole notion of insanity. It's useful up to a point, but we've gone beyond that point now. Okay, but beyond that, a lot of stuff that is useful up to a certain point, and then it's no longer really useful, it just gets in the way. So at this point, I'm discarding that because there's a much better way to look at it. Way more leverage, because it brings a stark black and white type of clarity on the whole situation. Either the prime creator can change reality or the prime creator cannot change reality. That is black and white, totally stark, right? And at that point, you realize that two belief systems must arise out of those two positions, right? You can see that extremely clearly, right? And the one belief system is a waiting type of thing, and it's a way of trying to pretend that we're very confident that this is going to work. And that, I mean, as we're waiting, we continue to build on this power more and more and more, putting the pressure on the prime creator. And yet we expect the deal to be done every next moment, next moment, next moment. So we keep running from this feeling of futility. We say, yeah, we feel futile now, but the next moment's full of promise, right? And we just keep advancing moment by moment by moment like that. The next moment's full of promise. And we can leave this feeling of futility behind because prime creator is likely to crack under the pressure. So we keep applying the pressure. So that's not insanity. That is very intelligent design, isn't it? It's a plan. It really is a plan. And we're feverishly following that plan. And we all have to present like a united front that we're confident this plan can work. So nobody should ever say, you know, like, hey, you know, are you sure this is going to work? No, we're all trained to be entirely confident to the point that we don't even doubt it. So we don't even admit there is a plan. It's like it's a fait accompli. That is literally the belief system of the world, that one of the belief systems, you know, that we have been enmeshed in, that is that it's a fait accompli. So it's even beyond a plan. It's something that is for sure going to happen. We just don't know when. We just don't know when. And so that is why we're strung along life after life after life, minute by minute, moment by moment, moment by moment, minute by minute, hour by hour, day by day, year by year, life by life. We're strung along by this belief that it's a fait accompli and it is certain to happen at some point, that the prime creator will crack under the pressure, under this threat, that we've developed some power, and that if the prime creator doesn't change reality, we'll use that power to destroy all of reality, and so it's a fait accompli that the prime creator will crack under this pressure and change reality for us. Tiny little bit, we'll make a deal, a little bit, which of course would change all of it. And so we just assume it's a fait accompli, so we do not investigate this situation at all. So the difference between one belief system and the other belief system is that one belief system does not investigate the situation at all. Whatever investigations are pseudo at best. Whereas the one that believes the prime creator cannot change reality at all. Therefore, all of this attempt to build up the pressure on prime creator through loss is completely futile, waste of time. And then that belief system then absolutely investigates the whole thing very deeply. And that's what I've been part of, is really dig into it every day, really investigate, see what's going on. So you have that belief system that will investigate, the other belief system that will not investigate at all. All investigation is just completely pseudo. It really has nothing to do. It's kind of trying to short circuit any investigation. And just kind of say, well, we already know the answers and this, we'll just follow these things and, you know, take it on some authority somewhere established, you know, the parameters of investigation, we already know all that. But that authority would be someone who says, hey, it's a fait accompli, let's not really investigate this at all, and aware that we have this desire to investigate it, because we're kind of suspicious. So do a pseudo-investigation of it, and then call it good. And then you have all this stuff in the world that is just pseudo-investigation. It's not real at all. It doesn't get, and that's what I've seen. I keep looking for, you know, where are the investigations into existence that are truly significant? Very rare, super hard to find them. They do exist. That has taken place, and there are those who have done it. But overwhelming majority of anything that's pertaining to investigating existence and what's really going on is entirely shallow and pseudo, and merely is a delaying device, is a device to keep us waiting and waiting. And not breaking ranks and not really investigating, because we think it's a fait accompli and we're going to win. So if we're going to win, and in the end, why even investigate anything? We just need to keep on accumulating loss, which is what we do. Come on, keep more bodies pouring into this world, right? That's the belief system. Just keep producing more bodies, more bodies, more bodies. And what do these bodies do? They just, you know, eat, drink, and be merry, basically, you know, during their lifetime. They just go through their lives like zombies, never investigating what's really going on at all. Never. And simply accepting whatever pablum, you know, is given to them in terms of, well, this is the truth, and you don't need to investigate at all. And they say, oh, okay. Again, not insane, very clever. It's very clever. Because again, we believe it's a fait accompli that the prime creator is going to crack in any moment, any moment, next moment probably. That's what we believe. This belief system believes that. So this feeling of futility that we're living with, we somehow put up with it because we project into the future, saying we won't have it in the future. And that keeps us what we call sane, or keeps us from investigating the situation. What we call, in this world, what's called sanity. Sanity is to not investigate existence. Okay, that's called sanity. To investigate existence is called insanity. Okay, because if it's a fait accompli that we're going to succeed in this quest to break the prime creator and get reality change for us, then any investigation of this would seem to be a complete waste of time. Only a lunatic would do it, right? If it's a done deal, if it's a certainty, why even question it at all, right? Why demon spend time digging into it? So any digging into it really is seen as insanity. And those who simply are waiting for, are seen as the same. They're seen as the same. And of course, they're, you know, waiting is like very stressful, very difficult. So people, you know, drink, take drugs, and make medicines, and you know, they just look, you know, looking for a little, clutching at straws, trying to find little scraps of happiness here and there, get their, you know, giddy entertainments on, go through all their cheap thrills, and you know, just try and get by. But as, you know, every moment saying, well, I'm only doing it for this moment because the next moment, prime creator's gonna crack. And, oops, didn't happen. Well, the next moment, oops, didn't happen. Well, the next moment, oops, didn't happen. The next moment, like that. And we try to dull ourselves down. And again, don't make any search into it. Don't even inquire into it at all. And we believe non-inquiry is the height of sanity, that we are not off on a fool's errand at all. And so we pat ourselves on the back and say, wow, we're really smart because we're not off on any fool's errand. We are preparing to be prime creator. You know, next moment we're going to be prime creator. We're going to be greater than God the very next moment. Whoops, it didn't happen. What must be the next one? And people literally go through their entire lives just like this. Almost everyone, exactly just like that. And then on the other hand, those who have the belief system that prime creator can't change reality, they go through a very different life. My life has been entirely different than almost everyone's here in this world, entirely different. Really cannot even imagine the difference, you know. Completely intense. Just extreme intensity of trying to see through all the little tricks we use to keep ourselves waiting for the prime creator to crack. There's so many little tricks we've developed, you know. We keep developing more and more and more. Because this feeling of futility is like trying to devour us. You know, we feel trying to ruin our hopes. You know, we feel like we're gonna crack. You know, it's kind of like a game, who's gonna crack first? Prime creator or us? Are we gonna crack and give up and say, ah, it's too difficult? And it's a matter of pride. You know, it's pride, spiritual pride, not to crack. So we have to develop all these techniques and tricks to keep from cracking and giving up and saying, wow, I'm tired of this loss. That's not what I really want. Okay, prime creator, you win, that kind of thing. But it's not a winning because there was no contest in the first place. It's impossible for prime creator to change reality. So there never was a contest. So our pride was never at stake. And yet we think it is. We believe it is. Because we believe prime creator can change, just doesn't change reality, just doesn't want to. Because doesn't want us to be greater than prime creator. That's what we believe. So we believe our pride's at stake and we need to win this. And if we give up, we're going to be unhappy forever. You know, we'll be broken. And the prime creator will stuff us down somewhere and bury us. So we never can rise again, you know, and try this trick again. Never try this again, you know. We feel, well, we could have done it, but we were broken. And so prime creator will certainly destroy us. So we never try it again, because next time we might actually succeed. You know, that's our fear. Like we'll be cast down in the deepest hell if we, you know, give up. We annihilate the prime creator, annihilate us. That is the terrible beliefs that can arise from this belief system that the prime creator can change reality. It all stems from that. Ultimately, it stems from our desire to be prime creator. But this desire could not be entertained at all if we didn't take up the belief that Prime Creator can change reality. Right? So that is really the crux of the situation that we're faced with. And if we believe that is so, then boy, we get into so many fears, drastic fears of annihilation and pride and having to, stick with the situation here. Whoops, I see that I did not connect the microphone. The webcam is recording this. Yikes. How about that? Can I connect it now? I don't think so. Wow, so the video is all going to be terrible, huh? Let me see.
1, 2. All right, there you go. Sorry about that. I hope the audio comes out. It should be better now. Maybe terrible. I'm sorry about that. Wow, little mistakes. Too bad. You have to do, one little thing undone. It can be troublesome. So we are, again, with this heightened audio, these two belief systems. We are struggling. Which one? Which one? Which one? Which one? Which one? Which one? Okay, let me stop this video. That's a good start. And let me see if the audio turned out okay. All right, because it's been a great video. But if it turned out lousy, I may have to, redo it. Yeah, it probably turned out pretty lousy. I don't know. Okay, let's stop this one. If you can hear the audio, then it's been actually a great video. Okay. Thanks for watching. That's it.